At this point, I want you to turn around. If there's anybody shorter than you behind you, trade places with him or her. Let's make sure everybody can see. And ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to one of the most famous rooms in the country, the Assembly Room, named after the Pennsylvania Assembly, and on the back of a $2 bill, you see an image of this room. The American Revolutionary War was going on around Boston. Let's go to June 1776. Here at the Virginia table, you have Richard Henry Lee. He puts forth a resolution, a proposal for independence. John Hancock is up there at the head table, and he pulls together a committee of five men to work on and to write a Declaration of Independence. I'm going to say their first names. Guess who's going to say their next names?
Us.
All of you. So the five men who worked on the Declaration of Independence. Thomas.
Thomas.
Jefferson.
Benjamin.
Franklin. Franklin.
There's another John in the room, and his wife's first name is Abigail.
Adams.
John Adams from Massachusetts. And from New York. His last name begins with L. His first name is Robert.
Robert.
No.
Livingston. Robert Livingston. And from Connecticut, last name begins with S, first name is Roger.
Roger.
Sherman.
Sherman.
All right, to be fair with you, most Americans never heard those two names. If you're from the New York area, yes, remember Robert Livingston. But everybody else in the room, people from other countries too, I want you to know the name of the man from Connecticut, Roger Sherman. I'll talk more about Mr. Sherman later. Remember his name. So those five are working on it. Well, by the way, the Declaration of Independence was not signed on July 4th. It was that summer, 1776. But let us start with the most important date, according to some of the founding fathers, July 2nd, because technically, that's the date we broke away from Great Britain, as Congress adopted Lee's resolution for independence, but not signed. July 4th, the New Yorkers over at this table are holding out. They need to go back to their state, get permission, then come back and report. But the 12 other states approved and adopted the final wording of the Declaration of Independence. So the text was approved, but not signed. I don't know if you had a chance yet to visit the little building next door. It's called the Great Essentials Exhibit. There's three rare documents on display there. One of them is the Declaration of Independence. And that's what happened the night of July 4th. We believe about 200 of these were printed. These are to be published in the newspapers, read to the general public, and to the troops in the field as quick as possible. Think about it. They have more important business to attend to than signing a document. For example, what type of government should we have? They split up the power between 13 states, and they called it the Articles of Confederation. 4 days later, it's read out back. And then finally, on July 19th, they hear from New York. And yes, they have voted for independence. So now it's unanimous, all 13 states. Hancock orders everybody come back to sign the official document on August 2nd. And that's when it was signed. Who knows who signed it first and largest?
John Hancock.
John Hancock, right. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not the original. That's in Washington, D.C. As a National Park Service ranger, I feel obligated to inform you there is no treasure map on the back of it. So many people ask me about that movie, National Treasure. Well, let's put this in a proper perspective. This was the easy part. Any country can declare independence and sign a document. But to win your independence, now that's a different story. Look around the world today. Back then, we were going up against the British Empire. We were losing many of the battles. We finally turned the tide, though. We officially got help from three other countries, the Netherlands, Spain, and
France.
We finally won a major battle, fall 1781, in Yorktown, Virginia. The war was basically over. The Articles of Confederation were ratified that year when Maryland signed on. That form of government ran by consensus. Just imagine now if our government ran by consensus. Do you think we would get anything done?
No.
Luckily for us, James Madison realized that major weakness, something had to be done. So in the summer of 1787, he pulls together in this room the Constitutional Convention. Their job is to revise the articles, make some changes. But the first vote, throw them out, start over. They're not following state orders. Now they're meeting in secret. There's stories about the windows being locked so nobody can eavesdrop like the press. All right, all the adults, you gotta keep quiet. Kids, I have two questions for you. Do you think they had air conditioning?
No.
Would you say politicians are friendly to each other?
No.
They do a lot of arguing. But as you also probably know at your young age, good politics is about compromise, being flexible. And that summer, we had some of the best politicians of the country in the room. Benjamin Franklin. And who remembers? Who was the man from Connecticut?
Roger Sherman.
Right? He gets credit for the great compromise. Some people call it the Connecticut Compromise. Basically what he did, he took the best of the Virginia Plan and the New Jersey Plan, put it together, and that created in Congress an upper house and a lower house. In the Senate, two senators per state. That's good for the small states. New Hampshire, Rhode Island, New Jersey, and Delaware. But in the House of Representatives, the larger states have a louder voice. North and South Carolina, Georgia, Maryland, Virginia, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, New York, Massachusetts, and California.
Huh? Yeah. What?
Good, you're paying attention. There is no California. That's the secretary's table. But now I want you to imagine George Washington on September 17th, signing the U.S. Constitution. Benjamin Franklin makes a strange comment that day about the chair. On top of the chair, there's a carving of a sun. I've been sitting here throughout the course of session, looking at that sun behind the president, trying to decide if it represents a rising or a setting sun. Today, I have the happiness to know it is a rising sun. Of course, it was his optimism. Something really was born in the world that day. It's no longer about kings, queens, emperors, czars. It's about we the
people.
It went into the ratifying conventions. Three men started to write the Federalist Papers to convince delegates to go forward with the Constitution. James Madison, John Jay, and I hear there's a musical named after the third fellow. Alexander Hamilton, right. By June of 88, when New Hampshire signs on, the Constitution has been ratified. The rest is history. There's only four original objects in the room. I'm going to finish up my talk here in the next 1 minute. Finish up all your pictures in that same minute. Then we're going to quickly go upstairs. Four original objects. Thomas Jefferson's black walking stick. On the Delaware table, the brown walking stick belonged to George Read, the small feather quill to Caesar Rodney, and the rising sun chair. Everything else in the room, like that chandelier, is a period piece. So now you're going to go up the original staircase. Think about the famous people who touched that railing. You're going to go into the largest room up there. You'll see benches all the way around the edge of the room. Feel free to sit down or stand along the edge of the room. I need the center of the room clear, so stand along the edge. Meet you upstairs. And after my concluding remark, I'll give you a chance to explore for only about 4 minutes. The long gallery for special events, music, for example, from the harpsichord, maybe dancing. Two original portraits on the walls, Andrew Hamilton, no relationship to Alexander. Andrew oversaw the construction of the State House. And if you ever heard that phrase, the Philadelphia lawyer, which means tough lawyer, that's him. He started it. His son James became lieutenant governor. There's some old maps on the walls. There's a little room over there called the committee room. Whoever gets to it first opened up both blue doors. You may want to take a quick look in there. The most important room, though, is over here in the corner called the governor's office. Above the fireplace, you're going to see a painting of William Penn, the founder of Pennsylvania. You're also going to see a strange object in there called a transit. It looks like a telescope. But that is the original transit that was used to survey the boundary between Maryland and Pennsylvania back around 1750 by Mason and Dixon. Of course, I'm going to be available for questions. And when you hear the music start at the harpsichord, you are welcome to dance. But when the music ends, inside voices and quietly go down the steps. But boys and girls especially, I hope in a very short time together, you have discovered the birthplace of your country. The Declaration of Independence was signed here, but more importantly, the U.S. Constitution was debated and signed in this building. This is the beginning of the American Republic. Have a good day.
Thank you.